today is going to be about economic inequality and what we call the public banking solution. So Arizonans are hurting. Since the crash of 2009, our state has not popped back like some other states have. When Wall Street crashed the economy worldwide, many state budgets, in fact, all state budgets except for one in the United States, crashed too. And what did the governments do? They said, there's not enough money, and you guys have to tighten your belts, right? So people were laid off, budgets were cut, and they imposed austerity upon us because they said that the budget, there was not enough money to build the roads and to pay for schools and to do some of the things that we want to build a good society. So last week I read an article that was in the Tucson Weekly, and it talked about the median wage for women. The author had put up this story in response to Women's Equality Day, which was just a little over a week ago. And this analysis of the census data said that women in Tucson made a median wage of $10.75 an hour. That means that half of the women in Tucson are making less than $10.75 an hour. And it said that Tucson was one of the worst cities for inequality pay gap in the country. Today in the Arizona Daily Star, they quoted the labor statistics saying that the overall median wage in Tucson was around $15 an hour. So if you are involved in the fight for 15, you know, there are the SEIU, the Service Employees Union, is trying to raise fast food workers up to $15 an hour. So if you look at these two statistics, $10.75 an hour or $15 an hour, if we raise the minimum wage in Tucson, half of the town would get a raise because our wages are so suppressed in this town, and we have a low-wage town, and we still have a starved economy because the government, the state government, the city government, chose an austerity route. It chose to suppress wages. It chose to lay people off. It chose to starve our economy rather than growing our economy. And we're here to talk about a different way of doing things. We feel that the economy should be grown and that it should be nurtured in order to, like they say, when the rising tides lift all boats. That's what we're talking about with public banking. So when people think about the $15 an hour minimum wage, they often say, well, we can't raise it to that because businesses won't be able to afford it, and people will be laid off in order to pay a smaller number of workers more per hour. There was an article recently in the New York Times that said that if your city is considering raising the minimum wage, if your median income is, if $15 an hour is around 50% of your median income, then your economy is robust enough that you could raise it to $15 an hour and people wouldn't be laid off. Well, this works okay for high-wage cities like New York City or San Francisco or Boston or Seattle, but if you look at our median wage for women at $10.75 an hour, $15 an hour is 140% of $10.75 an hour, and it's 100% of $15 an hour if you look at the Bureau of Labor Statistics stats. Our town is that far out of alignment with wealth. Think of it, instead of $15 being 50% of the median wage, it's 140% of the median wage that women make in Tucson. It's time to stop austerity. It's time to stop starving our economy and start building our economy so we can have the good jobs and we can have good roads and we can have the schools that our children and grandchildren deserve. So whether you look at our median wages, $10.75 to $15 an hour, it's not enough, and it's time to raise up Southern Arizona and raise up our state and grow our economy. So how do we break this cycle of poverty? You know, the politicians are still saying that we need austerity because there's not enough money. We say that austerity is a lie. There's plenty of money. The problem is that the money is on Wall Street. Every state in the country except for North Dakota keeps their rainy day funds and their state funds on Wall Street in a too big to fail bank. So why did our economy crash when the Wall Street crashed? Because our money's on Wall Street. It's not here on Main Street. It's not being invested locally. It's local businesses, not luring a call center from someplace else or trying to steal a ball team back from Glendale that we lost a few years ago. What we need to do is we need to grow our own local businesses give our people better jobs. And so if you, right now our policies are moving Arizona backwards. If you look at what's happening in Greece, in Puerto Rico, these are countries where they have had full-on austerity, they have borrowed too much money from the world banks, and they are, their citizens are just, the economies are crumbling. They've got 25-30% unemployment, I believe, in Greece. It's as bad or worse than it was in the United States in the Great Depression. So that's the road that Arizona is on. We don't want to go down that road anymore. So like I said, for Arizonans for a New Economy, our public banking project that Jim and I have, we say that austerity is a lie. It's time to bring our money back from Wall Street and invest it here in Main Street, America, and invest it in Tucson. So like I said before, all of the cities and states crashed their budgets when Wall Street crashed in 2009. The only state that didn't crash was the state of North Dakota, because the state of North Dakota has a public bank. And that public bank invests locally in the state of North Dakota for the benefit of the people. What a concept, right? Instead of investing our money on Wall Street for the benefit of the too big to fail banks' shareholders, which is what's happening with Arizona money, they're investing in railroads and daycare centers. The Bank of North Dakota returned so much money back to the state of North Dakota last year that they had a proposal in the North Dakota legislature, which is North Dakota is a red state, just like Arizona. They had a proposal in the legislature to start a $5,000 savings account for every child born in the state of North Dakota and hold it in the bank until they're 18 and give it to them to go to college. And what are we doing? We're raising tuition, we're cutting the community college system, we're cutting the University of Arizona, we're cutting K-12. It's time to stop starving our future. We're hurting our grandchildren. I'm a grandparent. I know a lot of you are too. What is our future going to be if we continue on this road? So 40% of the banks worldwide are public banks, but there's only one in the United States, and that's the state of North Dakota. It was started in 1919 during the first progressive era when farmers were being foreclosed upon by Wall Street banks. This is happening on the border in Arizona right now. Wall Street banks are pulling accounts from growers, family growers who have been growing lettuce and vegetables along the border with Mexico for generations. They're losing their money because Wall Street doesn't want to take a risk with them anymore. With a public bank, we could help those growers continue with their business, and we could grow that economy along the border. So the Bank of North Dakota started because the farmers took action. They banded with the writers and the academics and other people who wanted to take their state back. They had a coup. They started this group called the Nonpartisan League, and their slogan was, "Vote for the family, not the party." So they backed any party-affiliated candidate who would stand for the rights of women, who would stand for the rights of farmers, who stood up against the railroad who was charging the farmers too high of fees, and they took over the legislature in 1919. They established the public bank, and the Public Bank of North Dakota, the first office was in the grain elevator, because they also established co-ops for the farmers to strengthen the farming economy there. So they established the rights for women to vote when they took over the legislature. So anyway, this bank has been churning money into the North Dakota economy for decades, and we could do that here, and that's what Jim and I are trying to encourage Arizona to do, is to start public banking at the city level, because I think it would really help the city of Tucson to get out of this, you know, this downward spiral that our economy is in, but also at the state level, because it would also help the state. So one of the things that we talk about is the top 10 ways that public banking could help Arizona, okay? So you're gonna hear my top 10 ways now. So my first one is infrastructure projects. With a public bank, the state would hold its funds here in Arizona rather than investing them on Wall Street. And so that means, like, you know, a few years ago when the city of Tucson passed the bond issue to fix the potholes, you know, we had to go to Wall Street to borrow money back rather than using our own money to fix the potholes. So if we had a state bank, The state could lend the city of Tucson money at a low interest rate, let's say 2%. Right now, we're on the hook to up to 8%. If interest rates grow up, we're going to be paying a lot more for those potholes to get fixed. So if they could lend it to Tucson at 2%, the state would make 2%. We're not, the state's not making any money on these deals now. The state can make 2%, and the city of Tucson would save money, and we'd get our potholes fixed. We could use public money to fix our bridges. These would also put people back to work, and these are good-paying infrastructure jobs to fix the bridges, fix the potholes, build that train between Tucson and Phoenix. Come on, I've been waiting for that for 30 years, you know, so there's lots of things we can do with this. Number nine is create good-paying jobs. You know, we get good jobs with the infrastructure jobs, obviously, but construction jobs are short-term, and hopefully Tucson and Arizona has figured out that construction jobs are short-term jobs. They're not long-term jobs. But if you think about building the community banking system with public banking, building research projects at the U of A, it would actually filter jobs throughout the economy. It wouldn't just be construction jobs that we're talking about with public banking. Provide low-cost business loans. You know, we see the city and the state, you know, trying to bargain with corporations to move here, right? We've also seen a few corporations say, no, I'm not going to Arizona. You destroyed your education system and your roads are a mess, right? So what we need to do is, instead of chasing rainbows, chasing the next IBM or chasing the next Wiser lock or chasing the next Lockheed, you know, equipment facility that we used to have here, all these things, we gave them incentives to come and they all left us. We need to grow our own. You know, Al Perry has this song. He talks about the things that these other cities have, and he says, Tucson, we've got cactus, you know? Well, we do have cactus, but you know what? We could do something with that cactus. We could give seed money to the U of A and say, hey, go out and test all those plants in the desert, because we have a lot of unique vegetation, and most drugs come from a plant. We could go out and test all those. We could develop research, we could develop new drugs. We could, you know, foster local businesses that we have right here in town. We have a lot of artists and musicians. We have scientists. We could be the Athens of the West instead of the dusty Pueblo, you know, but we've got to think outside the box. Like I said, I meant number seven, strengthening community banks. Right now, we have a two-tiered system of banking, basically. We have Wall Street banks in Arizona, but we have local banks, community banks. And community banks are faltering in our state. They really got hit hard with the crash. They're a little stronger than they were, say, back in 2008, 2009. But these are the banks that make the small business loans. There have been studies done in other states that say that when a small business wants a loan, they're mostly using their credit cards. Well, if you miss a payment on your credit card and you got a $5,000 balance and your interest rate goes up to 29%, you know, that is not a sustainable way to grow a business. So if we, working with a public bank as a collaborator, a partnership bank, maybe to back loans, we can build the community banking system and we can build local businesses that are not going to go away because they're born and raised right here in Tucson and right here in Arizona. So the city of Tucson actually started what they call a community banking project a few years ago. It's like the best kept secret in town, with urging from Arizonans for a New Economy and Local First Arizona. They took $5 million of rainy day funds and they put it into, they did an RFP, they put it into Alliance Bank, and with that Alliance Bank made 16 loans. The largest one was a U of A spinoff business for $2.5 million for a medical equipment innovation, you know, invention. And then the smallest one was $16,000 to a woman-owned sign company. So they took that $5 million and they parlayed it into $9 million. It worked so well that Steve Kozacek, who wouldn't even talk to us about public banking at the city council meeting, says, can we increase that? You know, so now they're putting $10 million of Tucson, you know, the rainy day fund into Alliance Bank for small business loans. And this is what we're talking about. But I think that it's time for Tucson to step it up and go from just dabbling in community banking to actually having its own public bank. Another way that we could help, number six, is offer to low-cost student loans. The Bank of North Dakota is offering low-cost student loans and to to anybody who goes to school in the state of North Dakota. We could totally do this, you know. The other thing we could do is we could refinance loans. This is number five. People have a lot of debt. I have this friend, she's in her 30s. She just got married a few years ago. She married a guy also in his 30s. His student loan payment is $950 a month. He's been paying that for 10 years. He tried to get the Wall Street Bank to renegotiate. They said no. They can't start a family. They can't buy a house. They can barely buy a car. You think of an extra $950 a month out of a budget for two, you know, mid-30s, you know, young couple that's trying to start a family. That's a huge amount of money. A public bank could refinance that debt or excuse it. If they took that loan from $950 a month to $200 a month, just think how much more that couple could do. They could go out to the hub and spend $100 on a dinner, you know. Now they're eating at home, I'm sure, you know, and that puts money into the economy. Right now, the $950 is going back to Wall Street. It's not being spent in Tucson. So you can see how, especially since we're UUs and we believe in the interconnectedness of life, when these people are hurting, we're hurting, you know. We're all connected in this economy. So excusing personal debt or refinancing personal debt to make it more affordable is another thing that a public bank can do. Number four, fully fund public education. Thank goodness the courts have finally said that the state of Arizona has to pay that for schools, you know, and they're all saying, oh no, we don't have enough money. Well, we owe it to our children and grandchildren to fully fund public education, and with a public bank, this wouldn't be a problem. Like I said, remember, North Dakota is going to offer every kid who's born in the state $5,000, and we can't even have a decent school system. Number three, I mentioned this already, foster university businesses. These are the best jobs in town. I essentially work for a U of A spinoff right now. My job wouldn't be here if my boss wasn't a full professor at the University of Arizona. So I work for a U of A spinoff. But there are plenty of inventions. There's a lot of smart scientists down at the U of A. I worked there for 14 years. And they know, the U of A Foundation, they can tell you what the return on investment is for seed grants for young scientists. They go out, they get some preliminary data, and then they're more competitive for the larger grants from the NIH or the NCI. We could be doing that. We used to do that. The legislature used to offer seed grants to the universities, and all of that is stopped. And one thing, when a scientist goes to NIH and says, I have this data, one thing they look at, does that university have the support of the community and the state? And right now the answer is no, but we can change that. We could change that, we could grow research jobs in Tucson rather than to growing call center jobs in Tucson. Number two, one of the most important ones, protects taxpayer money. Right now, our money is in jeopardy because it's on Wall Street. We just had a little blip on Wall Street in the last week or so, right? Just ask Jim how nervous he was, you know? Because the stock market, all of a sudden, woo, you know, and then we're going, oh my God, is this it? But the thing is, our funds are in jeopardy. Wall Street crashed all the state's economies before they could do it again because they're not regulated enough. So if we brought our money back here and invested it in the public good, and it was the bank would not be controlled by politicians, it would be controlled by bankers, with that in mind. This has to be invested in the public good. How is this investment going to grow the economy rather than starving it? And the number one reason, I'm almost done, the number one reason for public banking is that it's a nonpartisan solution to grow the economy without raising taxes. And you know, everybody's afraid about raising taxes. This doesn't raise taxes, but it's a way that we can reach across any aisle. Like I said, it's not bipartisan, it's a nonpartisan solution, and I think that this is the way to go in order to get us out of the ditch. Arizona's been, I put in one of my rebranding slogans. I don't know if you've heard Governor Ducey said, we just have an image problem. We don't have an economic problem. So the slogan I put in was Arizona stuck in a ditch, because we are. So just to conclude, some next steps. There will be bills proposed in the legislature again this year. There were a number of them in 2014. The Unitarians were very helpful when we went to the day at the legislature in 2014. The bill that we carried a piece of paper to those legislatures and said, explain to them how important it was for this particular bill that studied the feasibility of public banking, and that is the only public banking bill that has ever gotten out of committee. So So we are working hard with the Mountain Vista Unitarian Church. They've adopted us as a shared plate Sunday charity. UUCT originally said that they would share a plate with us also. So the Mountain Vista is going to start house parties where they invite their friends and neighbors and talk about the top 10 ways that public banking can help and talk about growing in the economy. You guys could do that too. They're going to start letter writing campaigns when something pops up in the Star about, whatever, austerity or budget cuts or whatever, to have the parishioners actually start writing letters. And then on a personal level, I feel so strongly about this that I've decided to run for the Arizona legislature. And that's the end of my story. I'm glad that you're here. Glad that you're here. Please support public banking because it's time to stop, get Arizona out of that ditch. It's time to start growing our economy and stop starving it.